Hey everybody, I'm Cari Champion and I'm sitting with some living legends, Maverick Carter, Snoop Dogg, Nas, and Rick Ross. And we're here to discuss culture and crime cinema and how it all comes together in the Netflix upcoming film, The Irishman.
Back then, there wasn't nobody in this country who didn't know who Jimmy Hoffa was.
Snoop, I'll start with you first. Talk to me about legends who never die.
I think when you're talking about a legend, I think most legends are people champs. And when you're the people's champ, you live on forever because the people are going to continue to spread your name and spread your gospel. And I feel that's one thing about the legacy of Jimmy Hoffa that was betrayed many years ago. We didn't know about it. We just heard about it, but the people kept it alive. Even generations that wasn't even connected to us, they kept him alive to where his name was introduced into hip hop. Rappers started using his name because it made sense, because we figured out that he was a gangster and he was, you know, against the system, and he was about helping people get their money and get to what they needed to get to, so we could respect that.
A legend is definitely voted on and decided by the people, but it comes because that person made people feel something. When you see Michael Jordan shoot a fadeaway, it's always the same feeling. The first time I ever seen him do it, and that shit goes swoosh through the rim, and now if you put the same clip on I've seen 1,000 times, I still feel something that sometimes I might not even be able to explain, but I definitely can feel it.
Hello?
Is that Frank?
Yes.
Hiya, Frank. This is Jimmy Hoffa.
Yeah.
Glad to meet you.
Well, glad to meet you, too.
Even if it's over the phone. I heard you paint houses.
Yes, sir, I do.
First of all, that's the top three guys.
Period,
off
right?
The tippy.
Off the top.
That conversation that we just watched of the call of Hoffa calling Frank, just the look in his face, you could tell the weight of the call, even though Hoffa was not really giving him any instructions, but just the weight of hearing that voice on the other line, he could tell he had now been lifted and brought into a whole nother realm.
He
had
been accepted. Yeah.
He had leveled up.
That scene reminds me of a phone call that I got. I think it was 1991, and Warren G called with Dr. Dre on the phone. And to hear Dr. Dre's voice come through the phone, it was like the feeling I got watching that shit. Like knowing, like, this nigga can change my life. And I'm like just listening to it, trying to understand it all. And like, you know what? When I do finally get in front of him, I ain't gonna never leave you. And that's what that felt like. Real shit.
Yo, that gave me chills. That's my whole, that's like, childhood right there. Ross, what about you?
Me watching all those OGs interact, I felt like that was Hoffa welcoming the homie to the family.
Yeah.
That was him being accepted. If he, just for the record, you MOB.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah, boy, I heard you paint houses.
Only three people in the world have one of these. And only one of them is Irish. I have one. Angelo has one. Now you have one.
Snoop, he gets the ring. He's made.
Shit.
Welcome to the family.
That's like, I say that for rappers. Like in my era in the 90s, when a nigga got that Death Row chain, nigga got that No Limit chain, nigga got that chain, whatever represented your clique or wherever the fuck you was from, that chain meant every motherfucking thing. When you got it, you motherfucker had to be given to you by the colonel, by the general, or the motherfucking top dog.
I always knew, like, respect is earned. You're not given. You know, I always knew that. I never want anything given to me. And I can only appreciate a boss call from somebody like that. And that's the call that was made right there. It was like, you know, I see you.
Right.
I see you, you know?
I remember Lil Wayne told a story about how Jay-Z called him one day and just said, I see you. What was that moment for you, Ross, when you got that ring?
I got one of those calls from Jay-Z as well. You know, as I watched that clip, you know, to me that represent, you know, when a brother give you that ring, that represent that bond, that level of trust. You know, if something was to happen to you, you know, I'm gonna treat your kids like they mine.
Mm.
That's what that represent.
If they can prove it, they're just gonna want names from you, accomplices. That's all. You give them a couple names, you go home. Keep your job. What do you think about that? Would you do that?
No.
Would you give them names?
No. No names.
Old school. But old school is old school. Like, my father is the same way. Niggas don't say nothing, don't tell nothing. That's just how they get down, like, and I'm the same way. Like, I don't know how to tell on a motherfucker. I don't know how to give you up with a rat on you. Like, fuck that. Like, that's bitch shit. That was G shit.
We got here by being loyal. And loyalty rings true because we are placed in these seats because we were loyal to our beliefs, what we wanted to do, and the people who cared about us that helped us. You know what I mean?
When I think about it, it gives me a bit of a chill to think about the loyalty that LeBron had to me as a friend and as a business partner to say, take a chance on me. So I experienced loyalty from a standpoint of empowerment, of really giving somebody an opportunity, but giving them actually a platform. Because in life, anybody who makes it anywhere, we all have to have a platform. That's the loyalty that I experience that I can't, it gives me a chill thinking about it.
Like my relationship with Dr. Dre has always been, we never ask each other for nothing, right? That's one motherfucker that I ain't never asked nothing from and he ain't never asked me for nothing. But if we ever need it, we'll look out. And that's where the loyalty lies right there.
It is an honor for me to be here tonight to present this award to my dear friend, Mr. Frank Sheeran.
True OGs, and we saw them from young. You know, we got the movies you could pop in now when they was like kids, you know, Mean Streets, you know? And it just seemed like they real. It's not just acting. They know what that life is. They've seen it, they've been around it, and they can give it to us on the screen. So they were the best to give us that element of the streets, and we appreciate them. So I appreciate them coming together to give us this history right here.
Shout out to Scorsese for being such a brilliant director, bringing these guys together and capturing their talent.
When you think of Goodfellas, when you think of Casino and what those films meant to me, I still would debate depending on what time of day it was. You know, which one is better.
Right.
It just depends because they all have so many climaxes and so much game that I walked away from. You know, and most definitely this feel like that top shelf.
Top shelf, okay. Yeah.